Felix is, you know, we're hearing all about this illegal immigrants, illegals. Felix is forced into being an illegal.
Yeah.
He's got a cousin who says, look, you're living in this small, godforsaken little town. Your sisters are hungry. Your mother's hungry. If you come and work with me, you will make $10,000 this year. And for him, that's like $100,000.
He can't afford to say no.
Yeah.
And it's a typical story of so many of these young men that you find out in these sites. They are starving in Mexico. We know that. There's no money down there. And the cartels offer these opportunities to come up. What they say to Felix is, we'll bring you across, which is a hard thing to do in the first place. We'll bring you across for free, and we're going to drop you off in the site. All you have to do is grow for us for 4 months, and then we'll pay you, and you can go back and live your life. And he can't say no.
Yeah.
But here's the thing. Once he gets across, what they say to him is, okay, here you are. Here's the site. We expect you to bring this crop to harvest. If you leave, if anything happens, if anybody gets in here and takes these plants, we know where your mother and sisters are. We will rape and kill them, and then we'll come after you. And what Felix knows is that they will, because they do. And so what we have is this terrified young man who's never been outside of Mexico, doesn't speak English, isn't educated, with this job of not only protecting the plants, but protecting his family back home.
And as you describe, his coming, like with the coyotes, over the border.
Yeah. I find that heartbreaking. I mean, the research I did to inform this character opened so many dark doors for me. He comes across, this happens every single day of the year, these people coming across, and the amount of people dying on U.S. soil, actually, in these harsh desert conditions, and with the cartel activity and bandits and everything else, it's really dangerous.
And not only that, there's a part of him, and I say this to you, the writer, when he's there and he's all alone, it's almost like Tom Hanks in the movie.
Yeah, actually, I agree with
you. He makes inanimate objects animate so that he isn't just stuck alone.
Well, you know, you have to think about Felix has lived in a one-room hut his whole life with his brothers and sisters and mother and father. He's never been alone in his life. And in Mexico, the family is so central. And so suddenly he's out in the middle of nowhere, and he can't even have a flashlight at night. And so how does he cope with that? And eventually he creates these imaginary friends.
Rigoberta.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's how he copes. And
And he's in sort of like the bottom of the hill, where up top he sees the castle that is Frank's. And to Janice, it's a prison.
Exactly. And so every night he looks up at the house on the hill, and the lights come on, and that's the most beautiful thing to him, because he's afraid of the dark too, which just is a little character quirk and makes it even more difficult.
And Pablo ends up, he would go and he wouldn't take a lot. He would just take enough to sell to his friends or his clients what he had bought. And I thought it was interesting. He didn't want to be greedy. He just had $500,000 in his safe.
Right. But it's funny because different, and this is what I saw out in the field, different cartels have different growing systems, and each camp had its own personality. And some of the camps were very neat. The latrine was off in one area, and the trash area was kind of organized, and then there was the kitchen. And then there were the slobs, where they're trash heap is in their kitchen, is by their latrine, and it's just a mess, and they're using more rodenticides and more pesticides. And so each one had a different personality, and I responded very strongly to that. And so when Pablo goes out and poaches off these different cartel sites, the guys that are really making a mess of the land, he has, you know, he's got no respect for them, and he steals a lot more from those guys than he does from the ones that are more respectful.
And it is then that he gets caught by Felix, and their relationship, without speaking each other's language, is a very interesting what you have developed there.
Yeah, thank you. That scene was kind of hard to write, to switching back and forth, the two cultures coming together, and somehow they understand each other. They instinctively understand each other.
And I kept thinking, Pablo's going to get killed.
Yeah.
Pablo's going to get
killed. So did Pablo. Pablo thought that too.
Yeah.
But no, Felix is a very kind soul. He would never, ever do that. So Even in the most, he was terrified, but he would never do that.
Fire is a constant in the hills of Malibu, and it does almost become a character in this book.
Yeah, yeah, it does, and it's, I think of the fire in a couple different ways, because, I mean, it's a reality of the place. As you know, in Malibu, it burns every couple years. We have a big fire. Yeah. But also the fire acts as a, it makes the story almost into a fairy tale for Ellis, because her dreams really do come true finally. The land is cleared. There's a, it's almost, you know, she gets to start over. We all get to start over. And so,
psychologically, tell me about Frank, because Frank suddenly turns on Ellis, and he's no longer the sort of patsy for her. He becomes the slave owner as opposed to being the slave to her.
Yeah.
And she finds that attractive.
Well, I think a couple things with Frank. He is a very rich boy. He's a little rich boy who's always gotten everything he wanted. And so he had this dream of the vineyard. And if you, you know, you notice in the book, he finally gets the vineyard, and it's good for a while, but now he has that. So that sort of loses its appeal. He can't get a handle on Ellis. And so he keeps trying, and she keeps kind of pushing him away, and finally she cracks open that door just a little bit. And I think what happens with Frank, it's once again, once he gets it, he loses interest, he moves on. But for Ellis, it was very significant when he's about to leave and she stops him and says, come back. That's not characteristic. Her showing weakness is something she doesn't do.
Yeah.
And so I think she's actually very hurt by that.
Are you going to write a sequel to this?
I'm going to go down Felix's road. By opening these doors to the migrant issues and the trafficking and the cartel stuff, I had no intention of going on with it. I finished the book, turned it in. I was working on another book, and I kept thinking about what I learned when in the construction of Felix, and I can't turn away. So I'm going to be writing a book about border issues, Mexican drug cartel, migrant issues, and racists, because this is, you know, we're in the midst of a firestorm here.
Did you spend time down in Mexico?
Visiting. I've spent a lot of time lately, especially on the border. And I have a friend, so I've been on the border on our side in Arizona and California. And it's very disturbing to me what's going on with the border stuff. You know, we put up our 800-mile wall, Operation Gatekeeper, to stop migrants from coming across in the more populated areas like San Diego. In some areas, the wall is four walls thick. It's very effective. But what we've done is funneled them into the most hellacious deserts, and we have people dying on U.S. soil. I mean, huge numbers, thousands and thousands of people. And I just find this unconscionable. So I've been down on the border. Yeah. I've been talking to people and been doing research in that area.
And I remember George Murphy, when he was senator, saying, well, of course we need them. They can do, which is true, the work that others don't want to do.
And the hypocrisy of our policy is that we say to you, we're going to make it as hard as possible to get across. And in fact, you're probably going to die. But if you make it, we have plenty of jobs. We need you to pick our food and et cetera. So I need to write about that.
I am going to ask you, though, if you will read from your book, because there is also Katie Arnoldi, the writer, and I want them to hear what you can say.